Hi, thank you very much for being here. I think we're going to get started with the second panel now. My name is Amanda Parmer. I'm the curator for the Vera List Center for Art and Politics. I work here with Karen Cooney, who is the director, Emily Donnelly, and Zoe Carey. I just wanted to mention briefly at the beginning that we have a selection of our publications for sale on the left-hand side of the room. And also to begin by thanking Sondra Perry, who has been a wonderful collaborator and instigator of this program. So Sondra reached out to us earlier in the year, and she helped us to figure out that we would collaborate with both Union Docs, Christopher Allen and Jenny Miller at Union Docs, who hosted last night's screening, and also with Rebecca Clayman from Electronic Arts Intermix, who played a critical role in helping to select and present these films last night. So over the last couple of months, we've had these incredible conversations with Sondra that have helped us think through the idea of hypervisibility, and we've been talking about in that context how representations of Blackness are recontextualized and recirculated at increasingly accelerated rates. And through that, we've alighted on two conversations, the first of which took place this morning, and the next one, which we're about to begin now, which is moderated by So Young Yoon. And Greg Bordowitz is participating along with Mendy and Keith Obudike and Greg Tate. So they'll be talking through how artists and activist communities inform and are responsible to one another, and the ways in which the material stakes change when these representations of communities traffic between art and activism. And in that, they'll think about the historical examples that we carry forward into the present from these. So we're hoping that there are questions that are generated by the audience that can be incorporated into the conversation. So again, we'll be passing out these index cards. And if you all could write any questions that you have, I think we'll begin collecting them about 20 minutes in. So just pass them to the back of the room as you have them, and we'll collect them over the course of the conversation and hand them over to So Young, who will sort of DJ a conversation of questions from the audience and her own. I also, just before passing this off to Sondra, if you'd like to say a few words in a moment, just to briefly mention our 25th anniversary conference, which will be taking place on the 3rd and 4th of November. It will include a keynote conversation from Sadia Hartman and the winner of our prize for art and social justice, Maria Teresa Alves. So we hope that you'll join us for that. And there's more information about it on our website. And with that, it's a pleasure to introduce Sondra Perry.
Hey everyone, thanks for coming again. Thanks for staying through the last panel. I don't really have much to say. It's actually not going to come up. I forgot. But I do want to say that sitting at this table are some folks, artists, theorists, people who have been incredibly informative to my practice, and I am so hyped to hear everything. That's all I got to say. Thank you.
So I just wanted to begin by saying thank you to Sondra Perry and the Vera List Center for this amazing invitation. I am just as psyched to be in the proximity of many of my heroes. And I also wanted to add that following the dynamism of the first panel, I hope that we could also continue the discussion about some of the profound urgency, like, of the work of the artists who are participating in that first panel, like, as part of our discussion, like, for today. And so one of the questions, like, that was presented, like, as a, I realized my role was in part also to introduce you, like, to to the panelists, like, other than mentioning that they are my heroes. So Greg Bordowitz, like, is an artist and writer. His films, including Fast Trip, Long Drop from 1993, A Cloud in Trousers from 1995, The Suicide from 1996, and Habit from 2001, have been screened and broadcast internationally. A collection of his writings, The AIDS Crisis is Ridiculous and Other Writings, from 1986 to 2003, was published by MIT Press in 2004. Bordovich was also a contributor to the Vera List Center for Art and Politics 2009 publication, Considering Forgiveness, which you can see over there. Bordovich has received a Rockefeller Intercultural Arts Fellowship and a John Simon Guggenheim Memorial Fellowship, among other grants and awards. He is currently director of the Low Residency MFA program at the School of the Art Institute of Chicago. Especially for those of us who are in New York, you can currently see his work, like in the exhibition at the New Museum, Trigger, Gender as a Tool and a Weapon. And next to him is Greg Tate, so we have two Gregs on the panel. Greg Tate is a writer, musician, and cultural provocateur who thrives in Harlem. Tate was a staff writer at the Village Voice from 1987 to 2003. His books include Flyboy and the Buttermilk, Essays on American Culture from 93, Everything But the Burden, What White People Are Taking from Black Culture from 2003, Midnight Lightning, Jimi Hendrix and the Black Experience from 2003, and Flyboy 2, the Greg Tate Reader that was just published last year, like 2016. Tate is also a founding member of the Black Rock Coalition, and he has led the conducted improv ensemble Burnt Sugar, the Orchestra Chamber since 1999. And Mendy and Keith Obadike make art, music, and literature. They have exhibited and performed at the New Museum, the Studio Museum in Harlem, the Whitney Museum of American Art, the Metropolitan Museum of Art, and the Museum of Modern Art. Their projects include a series of large-scale public sound art projects, Blue Speaker for James Baldwin at the New School that was commissioned by the Vera List Center for Art and Politics with Harlem Stage, Free Phrase at the Chicago Cultural Center and Rebuild Foundation, and Compass Song commissioned by the Times Square Arts. Their recent gallery exhibitions include Number Stations, Furtive Movements at Ryan Lee Gallery, and the group show Electronic Superhighway at the Whitechapel Gallery in London. Their honors include a Rockefeller New Media Arts Fellowship, a New York Foundation for the Arts Fellowship in Fiction, and the Lewis Comfort Tiffany Award Biannual Award. They are also members of the advisory committee of the Vera List Center for Art and Politics. So, if you could join me again in welcoming them to this discussion. Thank you. So there were two questions in particular that were circulated like to the panelists as a way to frame our discussion. One was, what is the function of the distinction between art and activism? The question here is not so much the definition of art versus of activism, knowing the long history, like, and the difference in politics and aesthetics of the very distinction itself. What does it mean to differentiate art and activism? So the question was the very function of this distinction, like the function of this difference between art and activism. Is it a useful distinction? Is it a necessary one? And what is this distinction for and for whom? Like, does it affect the artist? How? How does it affect the audience? But that was one question. The other was about, like, how does art or put pressure on what we might conventionally consider activism? So the new Oxford English Dictionary describes activism as, quote, the use of vigorous campaigning to bring about political or social change. And one of the questions was, can we put pressure on such definitions of where and how activism takes place? Noting here the definition of vigor, vitality, or the military term of campaigning, the idea of taking an open field. Again, also the very nature of what we mean by change, the modality of change. How does the relationship between art and activism put pressure on these conventional ideas of a work to take place, to act? And part of that was also led into a more open question about what is the difference between a representation, a presentation, and an action. Now, to begin our discussions, and I will return back to the table, I thought that one way that we could start today's discussion was also to look back to yesterday's screening like, and also the first panel, and begin with some of the questions like that the screening and the panel initially raised. And for me, as a framing example, the work that I wanted to share before we start our discussion is this painting or a triptych of prints by the artist Kerry James Marshall called Heirlooms and Accessories from 2002. And I wanted to let the artist Kerry James Marshall talk about this very important work and how I think it especially resonates like with some of the problematics that have been posed throughout like this morning as well as yesterday's screening.
In Heirlooms and Accessories, there's always the difficult, how do you treat subjects of violence and brutality and get people to actually look at it and then to start to consider the implications of the thing that's represented. It's difficult to do with complexity because your emotional response to it is so raw and kind of visceral and kind of simple, let's say. I had come across, there's a photograph, a famous photograph of a lynching that took place in Indiana in 1930. It was a double lynching. The picture itself is shocking enough. And the thing is that this was an image that had been made into a postcard, which had circulated, you know, in the United States. But the thing that's most striking about the picture is not so much the brutality of the incident, but the casualness with which the audience are there as witnesses. How little regard for the rule of law, how immune they felt from prosecution. And so I, instead of dwelling on the lynching, on the brutality of it, that's the thing that struck me the most. Just how ordinary this all seemed as a spectacle. And so what I singled out from the photograph were three women who, they seemed to represent three different generations. And they all had turned to look at the camera, you know, in the instant that the photograph was taken. So the idea of accessories. Everybody who was there is an accessory to a double murder. Everybody who was present. Heirlooms are things that are passed down from one generation to the next. And so between these three women, you could see passing on the value that accrues to them from being a part of a regime that can perpetrate that kind of violence with impunity. Jewelry is an accessory. It is also an heirloom that is commonly passed down. And so it seemed really important to me to make these lockets as items of jewelry that these women could then pass down to their generations after that. It functions on all of those levels. Yes, these are heirlooms that they can pass down. And the power to inflict that kind of violence is also an heirloom that is sort of passed down. And so what I did with the photographs was to basically reduce the image of the lynching to almost invisibility. So it barely hovers there in the background. And then isolated the three women and put their pictures in these lockets, which are hanging by chains. So that becomes a kind of a mirror to the kind of hanging that's taking place in the image behind. And all of that together is framed in a thing that I think is sort of like a jewel box. So all of those things are things that I was trying to get at with this work. That this kind of violence has led to an inheritance that is not unproblematic, let's say.
So I wanted to think about yesterday's screening and this morning's panel and the beginning of our discussion about this term of this inheritance, like what then of our own looking as viewers. And what about this all too familiar recurrence of this spectacle, like now illuminated not with the flash powder of a bursting light bulb, a flash bulb, but now the blue light of our electronic devices, the pervasive glow of our television or computer screens, smartphones, or video surveillance cameras. And I thought that particularly yesterday's screening constantly provoked this question about what it means to watch versus to witness. Like James T. Green's short film, like, or non-film, spoke to the spectacle nature of it. Like, what is it that we anticipate when we see, and the particular complicity of our desire to see. Like, but along with the critique of the spectacular nature of this kind of violence, there was also works that were screened, like yesterday, that spoke particularly to the necessity to see, like to witness, not just to witness, but to record and to share and circulate. Right, and the kind of inheritance of this need, like, to record and to share. Like, for example, Arthur Jaffa's film, Sondra Perry's film, where the question of inheritance and especially how that gets transmitted from one generation to another, like, is something that both films and other films were consistently referring to. One more point, and is along with this necessity, right, to see, to record, to share, in the context of the contradictions and the problems of this seeing, this watching, this witnessing, is also throughout the films an assertion of this exuberance, like, or black joy, if you like, of this existence through the necessity and contradictions of sharing. Like something that, to refer to the title of Jitoya Gary's film, this ecstatic experience. And you could see that, like, in the way that dance was deployed, like, in the works, or music, for example. I'm thinking of the voice of Eartha Kitt or Kanye West's songs that were used, like, to speak to the particular nature of not just the difficulty, like, of this necessity, but also the exuberance that comes through circulations, through this, like, condition of circulation. And to speak to how that this can also refer to both the history, like, but also a certain utopia, if you like, of a collective being. Like, one that speaks to perhaps what the theorist Cedric Robinson called ontological totality, or the collective being of blackness. And I think that many of the, most of all of the panelists, like, here, like, through their writings, through their work, have spoken to, I think, this notion of a collective being, like, either through their art, through their activism. Like, what does it mean, like, to not just exist as a part of a collective, but rather to actually overcome the very dichotomy, like, of individual versus collective, like, not unlike that solar flare that you kept on seeing in Arthur Jaffa's film. Like, that is one way to overcome some of the very impasses in our discussions about race and class that was provoked, like, in the first panel. So with that introduction, I'll return back to the table. Yes. Hello. Okay, so it's me again. Yes. And I thought that we could start the conversation actually about, I would love to hear from the panel, like, some of their maybe responses or questions about, like, some of the films that we saw yesterday, like, and really, like, what and how that these, how these are particular strategies or tactics for trying to deal with a certain kind of, like, media representation, like, and the virility of it, like, the violence and the potential difficulty of this contradiction. Yes. Could I begin with Mendy or Keith? Yes.
Yes, thank you. I'm Mendy. I was thinking that I wasn't going to answer this, but just at the moment of your asking, I was thinking about a particular moment from Arthur Jaffa's film that I had been avoiding in the media or when it circulated in social media, and it was something that I, you know, I knew what it was. It was an image of a moment of someone being killed by police, but I hadn't seen it before. And I was wondering what I thought about, given the context, given the other films and the context of the conversation we're going to have, what I thought about finally seeing it in this context. And I thought, oh, you know, this, if I'm going to see it, this is the way I want to see it. Mm-hmm. And it made me think about the importance of the frame. I mean, it helps that I know Jaffa personally, so it's not just another black artist, but someone that I have actually had a conversation with. But even in the absence of that, I think the context that he creates in that film makes the looking not something that leaves you with a kind of hollow, alone feeling that you participated in the watching. You don't know if it's adding to the terrorism, or if there's something generative about it, because there's a not aloneness that happens in that reframing. And so that became an interesting perspective that I hadn't had before or thought about. Mm-hmm. So that's, I have other things to say, but that'll be what I say now.
Trying to think what I have to say about these works. I really have a lot of questions about the work. Like one thing about AJ's film, Arthur Jaffe's film, is, you know, I want to know from Greg, what, you know, since this is your boy, I want to know what kind of questions what kind of conversations you guys have had about that piece as it was in production and, you know, since it's been out in the world. I'm curious about that. I knew a little bit about AJ's piece. I think I'd seen the Tony Cokes piece before, but there was something really powerful about seeing all of these works together. In a way, I mean, I think this is sort of what you're getting at, Mindy. It's like, you know, there's some horror in some of these things, but when you see them all together, maybe, they might feel safer than they really are. So that was interesting to me. And then I guess just based on the topic of the panel, I was also interested I wanted to know more about the communities that these particular pieces came out of. So I was wondering if we could have a conversation about that. You know, so it was one thing to look at these individual works. It's another thing to know what kind of context, you know, produce these pieces, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, in response to the central problematic of the panel that was raised about this distinction between art and activism, it just made me realize that because of the way I was raised culturally, politically, I never got to experience a distinction between the two in living practice, because you know, people will ask, as you know, frequently Black people get asked by other Black people, you know, were you raised in the church? And I always say, yes, the Church of Black Power. You know, so I came from what was called a movement household. You know, there's a friend of mine who actually wants to make a film about these generations of folks that. Who were raised by folks who were, you know, part of SNCC and the Panthers and, you know, various grassroots, you know, Pan-Africanist organizations and so forth in the 60s and 70s. And but specifically, I grew up in a household where, you know, my parents were, they were at the March on Washington. They started an African-American cultural center in Dayton, Ohio. So they were bringing speakers in all the time, you know, Baraka and H.R.A.P. Brown, Eldridge Cleaver and Stokely Carmichael and, you know, the poets, you know, various, you know, poets, Sonia Sanchez and, you know, Nikki Giovanni and all these folks. And, but my mother was also, you know, a serious, music listener, you know. So, and I grew up with Sundays being devoted to her version of Heavy Rotation, which would be Nina Simone, Mississippi Goddamn, Otis Redding, you know, sitting on Docket Bay, Trial Low Tenderness, and speeches of Malcolm X, you know. And then there were Pete Seeger records that she liked, and then Lenny Bruce was in there as well, you know what I mean? So, but just the eye, and you know, when you live with people who are actually with parents who are off to this rally, this meeting, and so forth, like you just start to see this as like this is your cultural surround, you know, this is your cultural environment, you know. And so those, you know, later, you know, go to college, you learn there's this opposition to something called arts for art's sake, you know what I mean? But you know, I just never, like, that's what I, you know, that distinction was one I learned theoretically, mm-hmm. you know, but in terms of what I experienced in the home, it was, there was movement, there was a soundtrack to the movement, and then there was, movement work, mm-hmm. you know. The music of Phelan, the music of The Harder They Come, mm-hmm. became a part of that soundtrack as, you know, the movement evolved from civil rights to Black Power to Pan-Africanism to African liberation, you know, across the span of the early 60s into the 70s and 80s. And, you know, like, Mom was part of the election. She worked on the election team for Marion Barry, and then she was part of Run, Jesse Run, his first press secretary, you know, for that campaign. So, you know, and the whole time, though, anytime she went anywhere in the world, she was bringing back amazing art from those places. So I grew up with art from their travels to, you know, to Haiti and Africa and Ethiopia. You know, Jafa, when he came to my house for the first time, you know, he saw this work of Coptic angels, you know, with swords, you know, and he just said, man, how different my life would have been if I'd grown up seeing these things on the wall in my house, you know. But so I'll stop there, you know, around that point. In terms of love is the message is death, one of the things, you know, that Arthur has been, AJ, or Jay, has been obsessed with is unacknowledged trauma. In the African American community, and I mean, he's been talking about that in terms of an area that in need of deep investigation and exploration, and then the whole notion of you know, psychotherapy related to that, you know, and how you relate, how you create a space inside of your art practice to actually begin to acknowledge that trauma and also create a way of not necessarily healing, but, you know, acknowledging the wound, the scar, so forth, you know. So there's a lot of scars in that film, you know. But then also he is Black music fanatic, like most of us raised in, and particularly of jazz and R&B, you know, Black pop music. And so that music is associated with, you know, these times of tremendous celebration and release and ecstasy and catharsis, you know, in a very routine way in the community, you know what I mean? He was raised in Clarksdale, Mississippi, you know, went to Howard, you know. So the music is, you know, is always accompanying Black people as we move through the space of whatever America has to bring in terms of attempted annihilation and additional trauma, you know. And so, you know, of course there's gonna be, for him, you know, that tension and release between those scars and you know, LeBron making an amazing jump shot, or, you know, Steve Curry making an amazing behind the beat, or, you know, my man with the Giants, you know, doing his amazing one-handed physics-defying catch, you know, because Jay, you know, he's a sports freak too. He grew up with, you know, football coach dad, you know, played all kind of sports himself. So, you know, and I was telling somebody, you know, the thing with Jay is, like, he's a fanboy about whatever he's into, you know what I mean? So, like, the diligence he brought to just studying cinema was the same that he brought to his electric football game when he was a kid, and comic books, and, you know, and then the jazz when he discovered that, you know. So there's that obsessiveness about trying to obtain anything that helps you understand the emotions, the sensations, the craft of those things, you know. But in the film, I mean, in the film, there's a moment in there where someone says, "I don't believe Black people are aliens," mm-hmm. you know, And he counters that with a picture, you know, with a scene of the alien, you know, and there's a whole conversation about, you know, that we've had for years just about these black monster avatars that appear in movies in the 70s that are clearly a response to, I mean, you know, you can go to Planet of the Apes on an alien, Darth Vader, you know what I mean? I mean, it's just so much, you know, about the way in which the movement penetrated the subconsciousness, you know, these films, so they had to. So, you know, these directors were pushed to create these monstrous power, black power figures, you know, in science fiction, you know. But there's also, there's a conversation there's a film that preceded Love is a Message, which is called Dreams Are Colder Than Death, you know. And Fred Moten is a recurring speaker in the film. And at the end, over footage of like one of the first marches of outrage around the verdict in Trayvon Martin's murder, you hear Fred saying, "I don't believe that black people are defined by horror," mm-hmm. right? And that's something that AJ disagrees with, or disagrees, you know, with Fred about. So that film is also exploring like that tension, mm-hmm. you know, not trying to resolve it, mm-hmm. but letting it play out in a sense and leaving you in your witnessing to decide on what side of emotional response do you cumulatively take mm-hmm. from those images, you know. And it's very interesting watching it because I've seen it with a number of different kinds of audiences, you know, and in some ways the things that are about the ecstatic or the cathartic or the celebratory aspects of the culture, for some people those are like the commercial breaks, mm. you know, because the trauma overwhelms the presence of you know, the antidote, as it were.
Thank
you. Greg? I wanted to say that I agree with Greg about the distinction between art and activism. Most of my career has been devoted to either ignoring the distinction or defeating that distinction. But I did, for the sake of the panel, come up with a distinction. But I'll share that later, because that will lead to another discussion. But there is a possible way to distinguish the two. The films, though, I find extremely interesting. To me, they go to the possibilities of a counterculture at this moment. And in some of the aspects that they share, if one can start to talk about developing or identify a developing aesthetic. I heard Arthur Jaffa speak a long time ago about the power of amplification. This is in the early 90s. And he was talking about the shift from acoustic to electric guitar and blues, and was testifying to that power as it was received by the body of the listener. And I think one of the aesthetics that one could discern in the newer videos that were made was an amplification, a focus on a kind of specificity or type of activity, be it a violent an instance of violence or a cultural reference, and then amplifying it through near repetition, not the same image, but like images, mm-hmm. And producing an acceleration as well. The media appropriations of the younger group, although Arthur Jaffa is not necessarily younger in this instance, but I think he's capturing something. And love is the message, and the message is death. By amplifying and accelerating the sequencing and the speed of the cuts themselves, Whereas you look at some of the older appropriation work that was offered as an example, and I think about that myself because I've been making work and using appropriation in my own video work for a very long time, that with the shift in consciousness around a television watching generation to an internet generation is about microseconds. Accumulations, amplification, and microseconds. And this might be a way to look at or talk about, get a handle on the aesthetics of what we experienced, what we experienced in those videos, and the way they land on our bodies. I think Arthur Jaffa's work made me feel most like, it might be a bit hackneyed now in academia, but it made me feel most like the angel of history, not like that I'm the angel, but I did feel blown back by the catastrophe, blown backwards by catastrophe, only able to see the wreckage in all its cacophony, and not be able to see the direction in which I was being blown. That's the figure of the Paul Klee painting that Walter Benjamin uses. Mm-hmm. As an example. So I felt the angel of history dwelling there. I also felt that there was the possibility of standing in the moment, in the now, in a way where one urgently feels like the now, how the now is constituted by the haunting of the past and the inability to see the future. The difficulty, I'm building more off this notion of the angel of history. I think horror too does play a role in at the level of genre. Resident Evil, I think brilliantly, Sondra, uses and mobilizes the codes and conventions of any number of horror films, from Amityville Horror to The Last House on the Left, or any number of those very famous movies, with actual experience, and did something quite different, which I thought was very powerful as an aesthetic move. There was a way in which Sondra Perry made the references perpendicular to the frame, which I thought was very interesting. So the text roll at the end is actually perpendicular to the frame and not completely captured by the frame. It exceeds the frame. Mm-hmm. But that's a trope that you see throughout the video itself, this circular move around the darkened room where one encounters the archival footage on television. So there's a doubling of, there's a reference of a reference, there's a framing of a frame. And a mediation where one sees Eartha Kitt performing on television, then revealing a figure who is maybe watching or not watching, there or not there, and then moving out of the house. Again, there was a perpendicularity and a use of space which that I felt described a kind of way of being or moving through the world that attached itself very effectively to the genre of horror. And I linked it to other examples in popular culture. I think Get Out was an extremely interesting film for many reasons, but if we can limit it just in terms of its relation to what we're discussing now, the use of the horror genre mixed with comedy to confuse affect, to come at the camera askew, mm-hmm. in a way one doesn't know exactly what to feel. I mean, one knows what to feel. I mean, I'm saying I felt a tremendous amount, but there was a surplus. And I think this is what's powerful about both art and activism, or why they're the same, because there's always a surplus of significance that escapes commodification, if you will. So that's why even commercial music can be part of a counterculture, as Greg was saying. that the movement had a soundtrack. That music is something that actually circulates in the world as a commodity. I'm not making a commodity critique here. I'm going back to another point that I want to make, but I'm getting lost in my points. I think that's enough. I've said enough for now. Thank you.
There's two wonderful threads, and I definitely want to go back to one of the primary questions about this distinction, non-distinction between art and activism and its existence as theory. Right? But just this one point about the screenings, and I was thinking about these terms about what it means to see these images within the context of a frame, right? But then the language of the frame is very, very, let's say, it's in flux, like in all of your responses. It's not the painterly frame, like that is rectangular, like with its perspectival, like form, with a privileged subject position for which you can see that there is a right position to see it, like, and through all of your discussions, there's this the language of accumulation, seeing it in series, like not seeing an image, but seeing it in that context, like the way that the image turns, like, and Greg, your term about like seeing something askew, like, so that there is both a sense that there isn't a quote unquote right image, like, that, and there's no right way, like, to see the image, but we're in it already, like, and that we can't quite get out of it, but it doesn't mean we can't find a line of flight through it, like, which I thought was really very compelling, like, perhaps, and of course the whole discussion about the surplus, like the excess, like, and I would love to pick up on that too. But maybe this is a good point to actually go to our one of our foundational questions about this distinction between art and activism. Like, what does that distinction do for you? Like, and like, can we come with like a working definition of the function of this distinction? Like, and yes, so perhaps we could start there.
Well, yes. I mean, I would say, you know, for us, this kind of distinction is a really important one. Mm-hmm. I mean, my opinion is that, you know, art kind of precedes activism, right? I mean, I think that for us, art is a way of getting at better questions. And you know, before there's activism, we have to have kind of a more nuanced understanding of the situation. So I think that for you know, I'm speaking for my half of our practice, that distinction is important.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting. It's very interesting to have this particular conversation with this group of people, too, because I think my feelings about the distinction, the function of that distinction for me, have everything to do with what I think I'm doing as an artist and also what I have thought I was doing and other people were doing in activist communities and communities with other people who are activists, which I don't identify as an activist, so that distinction is very useful in that. Mm-hmm. I do identify as an artist. I have identified as an activist before. I may sometime in the future. And I also I sometimes join with activists to do a work. But I remember having these conversations where people would say, if we could just get more everyday people in here. And then the next meeting there'd be more people, and they said, but we need the everyday people. And then, you know, and I said, well, maybe I'll leave, and then you can bring me into the room and feel successful. and there's a way that some of the things that I might want to offer people or communities as an artist, I understand when it's understood as activism, as it sometimes is. But what I think the identity that I have in that, or the thing that makes me want to do that, is something that I want to distinguish from the identity label of activist, because sometimes that is so heavily laden with other problems, you know, that gets in the way of whatever we want to do together. Mm-hmm. So, you know, like when Greg talks, I completely identify with the things that he's saying. So, you know, I don't
which
know.
Greg? Which Greg?
Oh, sorry. two when Tate, when GT says, you know, when he describes growing up, and I grew up in a slightly different but similar environment, I also identify with that story of growing up into a community that functioned in a certain way, and the place of art in that community was also very similar to me. But sometimes the language of activism for me is just, I want to just be a sensitive person, you know, and act out of the ethics of that, those sensitivities. Mm-hmm. And I think art helps me to feel more, imagine better, and decide how to proceed from there. So, you know, some people would call that activism, mm-hmm. you know, but sometimes not calling it activism for me is generative and helpful and clarifying.
It's interesting that there are certain conventions of about or conventional definitions of what we think an activist like should look like or should sound like or particularly what an activist work should look like or sound like, and I think that I was thinking about this formulation that art precedes activism for you and that allows you to ask better questions and. It seemed to tie in with the question about surplus and excess that we were talking about right before. And I think one of the problems I think about the conventional presumptions about activism is this a certain kind of fetish about what we think everyday people is. And so when you think, well, there's the everyday, and then there's the street, and then there's notions about use, and practicality, and all of these are very loaded terms with certain ideas of time and space and what is practical, what is efficient, what is immediate, what is urgent, and it seems that these definitions are the very first things that needs to be questioned. So perhaps, may I ask, also the both Gregs, but both of you spoke about a certain kind of wariness, about the distinction between art and activism. That there's a theoretical distinction, but perhaps there's also a practical distinction. And I wonder if we could speak maybe a little bit more about that before we unpack what art can do for activists and vice versa. Yes.
Well, I mean, I think that just in terms of terminology, I'm probably uncomfortable with not so much the binary, but activism as being the most valorized container for what in the African American political tradition we would call resistance, mm-hmm. right? Which there's just such a broad spectrum of ways in which one can be resistant. Mm-hmm. You know, and historically, people have found very macro and micro formulations of resistance that were also a way of not just countering kind of brute forms of oppression or responding to them, but also a way of certainly for an enslaved, dehumanized people, a way of claiming, reclaiming, you know, human agency, humanity. You know, there's, I mean, we know that the whole white supremacist imperialist project was so dependent on creating these categories of races. You know, and of philosophizing the ways in which non-white people were not human. You know, there's a famous passage by Hegel, you know, where he denies Africa even has a history, which means, you know, you're still in the pre-human, the prehistoric, when you're talking about Africa, the Africa that was supplying bodies, you know, for the slave trade. So, and there's a great deceased African-American poet, playwright Larry Neal, you know, who used to say that, he said to be black in this country is to always affirm something, you know, because when your very existence is considered to be less than zero, you know, in all of these ways in which you counter this notion of non-humanity, non-existence, you know, become, I mean, very palpable, powerful forms of resistance. You know, Fred Moten in The Break, you know, he has this beautiful reformulation of Marx, you know, where Marx is talking about, you know, this whole notion of objects being voiceless, you know, and Fred just reminds that the kind of disruption and dissonance that resistant, conscious black bodies and beings entered into the slave system by being objects that spoke, you know, that essentially, you know, the first recognition of a sense of a certain sense of psychosis, you know, among the slave masters was just the realization that they really had to act as if you were a horse or you were a garden tool, you know, or a farm animal, you know, farm implement, you know. But in fact, there was a human being kind of threatening that denial of existence to assuage a certain guilt around what was being done to other human beings, you know. So, and, you know, there's, you know, I have this essay, you know, I have about Kara Walker's work where I talk about, like, a lot of discomfort produced by her work has to do with it being the non-heroic model, you know, of what happened to enslaved folks, you know. And, but my own kind of, extension of that acknowledgement in her work is that when we know about all these very focused, specific, day-to-day forms of resistance that people enacted. So, you know, if the heroic model is giving us Harriet Tubman or Frederick Douglass, we realize everybody couldn't be Harriet Tubman or Frederick Douglass, but a lot of people figured out how to ground glass and forms of poison, you know, into the slave owners, you know, food, or to perform work slowdowns, you know. There's a really interesting moment in the Solomon Northrup book, The 12 Years a Slave, was based on, where they talk about the character Patsy, you know, and how she created a certain kind of dissonance inside of the enslaved community because she was working at this superhuman capacity when everybody else was trying to not work at all. You know what I mean? Yeah, you know. So along that spectrum of resistance, you know, you've got these very personal kinds of interventions that people can perform. And then, though, we have what we know as organized resistance. And again, because of the way in which art and culture was conceived inside of the, you know, the home I was raised in. If my mother, you know, put a painting by a Haitian painter on the wall of two sisters in the village, you know, like that painting itself, you know, is in that spectrum, you know, embodying a humanity that's being denied, and her claiming that work as being a representation of that, of herself, as a woman from the rural South who then, you know, becomes this global activist involved with all these organized forms of resistance, is also making this connection between the macro and the micro forms of resistance, which I think, you know, when you talk about the whole notion of bringing the the regular folks. You know what I mean? It's like, you know, I think any of us, like one of the things I know that people who consider themselves conscious or woke by contemporary parlance, privilege about one's ability to move, kind of move among all classes and nationalities and spectra of Black people worldwide. That's part of the inheritance from a Pan-Africanist, African liberation phase of the movement, in that folks claim their connection to Black folks worldwide, wherever they travel, and they find ways to participate. You know, not even find ways, I mean, like the point in being there is to actually connect, you know, with folks who are doing, you know, who are making it through the day to day, you know what I mean? And to be claimed by that community as well, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So that's another part of the whole thing. It's not just, you know, the radicals letting the real people in, but it's also, you know, are you bringing anything that people actually, in terms of your humanity, that people even want to claim?
Right.
You know what I mean? And, you know, I mean, the interesting thing is, like, inside of the, you know, the community, you know, I mean, I can use Detroit techno as a great example. Like, yeah, you had these four or five visionary cats who decided to create this revolutionary sonic form that has transformed the sound of music worldwide, you know, but they're very much products of that village. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? It was just, but they, you know, one of the things they say is just, yeah, Detroit is the kind of place where if somebody didn't like your music, they would tell you, you know what I mean? And, you know, you all could still be friends or not, you know what I mean? But it took place. It was an understanding that what you did was just what you wanted to do. It was not elevated beyond, you know, and, you know, it was not put in this elevated place. It was just, this was your particular kind of way of getting your freak on, mm-hmm. you know what I mean? Or the last thing I'll just say is, you know, my folks came from Memphis, so, you know, my pop looked at the whole Jazz at Lincoln Center project like very much askance, you know what I mean? Because he said, you know, the community I came up in, the musicians were not put on this pedestal above the community. They were part of our day-to-day experience, you know what I mean? And this is where you begin to, you go into the way in which the energy and the meaning and significance of something like jazz becomes siphoned off, you know, for the purposes of really kind of draining a certain kind of cultural potency from an idea like jazz, from being something that people in the community see as connected. Mm-hmm. To them. Or, you know, last thing I'll say, and you know, I said I was going to say last thing before, but I've had, you know, I've had this experience, you know, at studio museum openings in Harlem, where I'll be, you know, go to opening, cool ass party going on inside, all my friends in there, some of them got cool ass art on the wall, whatever, you know, but you know, you take a break, you go outside, and you're standing there kind of right between the foyer and the street, and Harlem comes up and says, "What's going on in there?" Which, you know, it speaks to, you know, like there's a certain failure to make that leap across the void, even with the red, black, and green David Hammond's, you know, flag up there. You know, I mean, like, you know, I mean, Thelma's Girl loved, you know, loved for you. And I know they do, you know, Studio Museum does a lot of work in the community, but there's just something about, you know, and maybe David Ajay's new architecture will counter this, where people will feel more invited, more welcomed, you know, by this institution that's been there for 40 years. Like, there's fundamentally something wrong with our conception of the activism around art that goes on in the studio museum that people are asking us, while a group of Black people dancing to a DJ, like, what's going on? You know, like, what these folks about? Yeah. You know what I mean? So, All right, that's my treatise. Sorry.
Thank you.
Maybe this will sound a bit provocative, but I have a qualm with the notion of everyday people. I've been on a lot of panels. I've been teaching, a classroom teacher for over 25 years. And I have been an activist, called myself that, called myself a lot of things. I've always been interested. My notion of identity politics is that you claim as many identities as possible to the point where the structure breaks.
Mm-hmm. Excellent.
And it's about the proliferation of difference, mm-hmm. Or differences. And I kind of miss that. I don't know, I just had to write something about Marlon Riggs' Tongues Untied for a MoMA publication. And I knew Marlon, we showed our films together, and the way that Marlon and Tongues Untied proliferates difference and speaks against monolithic notions of identity, the way the poets that he worked with, the other country's poets, Essex Hemphill, those poets in Essex also were testifying to the lives they were living in powerful ways that I would never deny the term activism to, whether they called it activism or not. I don't know if this is analogous, but I spent a lot of time thinking about queer film, and I kindly decided that queer film is a film made by a queer, a film appreciated by queers that we don't know the sexuality of the people in them who made them, a film that is censored by a Jesse Helms or someone who's queer hating, right? What's a queer film? Where's the center of that?
Yeah.
And I think that's the same thing about activism. You know, I think I'll say a bunch of things. I actually only believe that the only politics that are actually going on at the moment are the politics in the room. And I often feel like we get on panels or we talk on panels and there becomes an inside and an outside. Like, there's the people out there, and then there's us who somehow we know different. When I don't feel that to be the case, because, at noon, we were the people out there, and around 4:30, maybe later now, we'll be the people out there. This is a very ephemeral moment, and we're producing a politics now. And therein is also the kind of messianic opportunity. I won't go on too much about that. But I'm kind of working out of my own tradition, and so I was going to say activism. I don't want to go on too long, but there's a few more points I want to make, if I may. Activism. We have to also consider the flip side. So activism is often the reason how work has been excluded from museums. So any work that had any visible relationship to race politics or just simply pictured people of color was excluded from museums for a very long time. Any work that was visibly queer or showed homosexuality in any clear way was policed from the museum, right? And that work was often called activist work. Mm-hmm. And even the most abstract work was policed from the museum because it was made by known communists or known anarchists. And so this notion of activism, I've always liked it because I understand it from my experience of being an activist. As an organizer, it's always been very important, like going into rooms and organizing people to recognize that, okay, you can afford to get arrested, you can't afford to get arrested. Where's the privilege in the room? Who can do this? Who can't? Who can be a support person? I worked at the Gay Men's Health Crisis for 6 years in the late 80s, at the height of the AIDS epidemic. From my point of view, there was no difference of kind in activism, whether you were serving lunch to people with AIDS on the sixth floor, or you were on the phone helping people navigate social services, mm-hmm. or you could take the risk or render yourself vulnerable and get arrested handing out hypodermic needles on Delancey Street, mm-hmm. which I did. Mm-hmm. And so, full stop, pause. Can you be an activist in the art world? Mm-hmm. Is the way that Glenn Ligon has figured out a way to be a figurative painter using words a form of activism? Is there an aesthetic activism? Going back to Marlon Riggs. I'll pose that there then. Mm-hmm. One more thing, I don't want to cut you off, Mandy, but can I finish this point?
Please, yeah.
I think the other question for me then, rather than the activism versus art thing, is something that goes even way back further, isn't all art political? Mm-hmm. And I think all art is political. I still cling to that idea because I think art is still a special arena in culture where signification and meaning are discussed in their own terms. Signification and meaning are debated as such. It's a special arena. It's an arena where there are rules of exclusion and rules of inclusion, which always involves politics. It can appear as art really only if it appears as a commodity and enters into a system of exchange value, or is assigned that value and embraced by a constituency, not an audience. I'm not interested in audiences, I'm interested in constituencies. Audiences are organized to buy things, constituencies are people that share affects, sensibilities, and aims and ambitions. And the last thing I wanted to say is that for me, the larger question is the question of counterculture. Mm. Where are we with the counterculture? And it exists. And possibly it exists in a way that's not recognizable yet, or perhaps it exists in a way that it's happening all over. And so it's happening in the gallery, and it's happening on the street, and it's happening in community centers. And actually, it's maybe there's only a few people who traverse those boundaries. But I don't necessarily see a solution in raising activism over art or art over activism. I'm sorry, I went over.
Yeah, no. I feel like what Greg are saying in different ways. That I feel like what you're saying about activism is about what puts us in mind to act, or what acts on our minds in ways that we can embrace. And I can get with that. Mm-hmm. I'm with that. And maybe the distinction. Maybe I'm getting caught up in the language in a very different way from the way that you're hearing language, but with the idea that art practices say something about who we are, make us different, and accompany other actions is something that I'm totally on board with, you know.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think that if I look at just the area of music, and you look at this whole notion of music that becomes labeled or credited with being conscious or radical or revolutionary, you know, there are people who made choices to make music that they knew was going to have dramatic impact on their commercial value, their livelihood, their safety. Security, you know, Nina Simone, certainly at the top of that list. I mean, and she's somebody that we'll talk about making a decision, like having to actually think about whether or not she was going to become more outspoken in terms of her support for the movement, you know. And of course, we know the choice that she made. We know Paul Robeson famously said, you know, artist has the choice between being in support of slavery or freedom. You know, I've made my choice. We know the consequences of those acts. You know, Eartha Kitt, you know, who's turned up as an avatar in some recent projects, is, you know, somebody who, again, you're talking about people who are at the, who in a sense made their career being seen as just entertainers and kind of rose to a certain status and stature inside of the American entertainment industry. And she goes into Lyndon Johnson's White House and challenges him, you know, around Vietnam and, you know, her career. She pays the price as well. So, you know, again, like, you want to acknowledge different forms of resistance, you know, but then you have to acknowledge the people that paid, like, high prices mm-hmm. for mm-hmm. deciding to align themselves, you know, with Martin Luther King, Malcolm X, with, you know, the Black Panthers, so forth. So there's a way in which, you know, people continued in a way to pursue an artistic practice, but they aligned themselves, you know, in very public, vocal ways with folks who were frontline soldiers, you know. But also think about in this context, you know, James Baldwin, who in many ways, because we have so much evidence of him speaking out, you know, in public, in TV rallies, universities, and so forth, we may identify him as an activist writer, but he considered himself a witness, mm-hmm. you know, and he considered the reserving of that space to operate non-aligned to a specific organizational movement as a place where he felt his craft, his work could be most effective. Because there's also a degree to which people who are just critical thinkers, you know, by training or nature, go into any kind of organized form of resistance with a certain amount of doubt and skepticism, like, mm-hmm. you know, we're the heretics, mm-hmm. you know, the people who can't not speak of the discrepancies, you know, or the question, the logic, mm-hmm. you know, of a certain kind of pursuit. And that's functioning for me in that space. There's this space, I guess, between artists and activists, which we all occupy, called citizen. You know, so, and this is the way in which one's micropolitics become manifest every day mm-hmm. in the world. You know, I mean, one of the things that Facebook is a great record of is, you know, people actually posted in the ways in which they challenged, you know, various forms of, you know, what people sometimes identify as micro aggression. I think it's just aggressions, you know. Or, you know, Samuel Delaney, science fiction writer, he just once said, he said, you know, being Black in America is one prolonged racial incident. You know what I mean? So it just becomes this question of, you know, but those responses, in terms of people deciding to intervene, you know, they're born out of a connection to provocations of consciousness that occurred through these organized movements. I mean, you know, it's just there's just a great kind of byplay or you know, in tension, but exchange between people who feel they're most effective as some kind of avant-garde lone wolves, you know, and the progressive movements that they identify with, you know.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, to that point about Baldwin, I mean, I think Baldwin says something about artists
needing to sort of destabilize things or pointing
disturb
out
the piece.
Nothing is stable, yeah. Right? Mm-hmm. So the artist points out that none of this is stable. And I think in order to really sort of embrace activism, you have to believe that something is stable. There's something that you're building on in order to achieve a goal. And I think, you know, we all have our kind of natural inclinations. And so I think part of the reason I was pointing out that difference for me, the difference between mm-hmm. activism and art, is because, you know I lean towards sort of mm-hmm. pointing out the instability of these things.
Absolutely. Right. Maybe I can build up on that because it seems that there's a certain, let's say, agreement like about the functionality of this distinction, like, and that it in many ways it functions as an institutional distinction where the label like of activist like as an identity like is an overdetermined one that one can claim with a price, but is often also put on you at with certain risks like, and. And but particularly in relationship to that, I was thinking about like the history of this distinction, like, and this is a question that came from the floor too. But is there maybe a shift in current politics like, that makes that distinction between art and activism like shift? Like maybe let me rephrase that, because one of the things that I thought was very interesting in our discussion was about how as we try to move beyond some of the categorical distinctions between art and activism, how we open up a larger spectrum of resistance, Greg, to use your term, and I was thinking, other Greg, like about the way that I think is early on in this discussion about how a lot of the newer practices seem to be relying on not so much a politics of representation, but rather one of amplification, like micro details, micro movements, like affect, like a tone. And I was thinking that that it seems that we've sort of generalized claim, maybe there's a certain limit or an impasse that we've received about a certain politics of representation, like be it political and aesthetic, like that there's a certain impasse there, like that is seemingly perhaps more made emphatic by the current political climate, like, and that there's perhaps a newfound necessity, like to not only question what it means for an art to act, like, but the spectrum in which it acts, like, is that, yes. Yes,
I'm not sure, mm-hmm. I mean, maybe I understand what you're saying, but if so, then I would say, I don't know that mm-hmm. the current mm-hmm. political climate shifts what I think about that. You know, I mean, it's a horrible political climate, but I don't know that I feel that things are any more stable than they were before. From that perspective, I mean, I think maybe the answer is about like when I decide to ask all the questions that I have, and when I don't, may be different. Mm-hmm. But the importance of the way language works, or the way we identify inside and outside, or what it means for us to be together and also acknowledge differences, or where power is in the room, it remains the same. And even how I feel about representation or mm-hmm. the power of that, or the, you know.
If I could just follow up with a very specific question then, like I was thinking about your, a more recent work, like where I think it's Free Phase Project, like, and thinking about how you're using, going back to the freedom songs of the civil rights like era, mm-hmm. like, and particularly the second part of that project where it's Overcome, where you record with contact microphones the sounds of the Edmund Pettus Bridge, like in Selma, like Alabama, the site of Bloody Sunday, and you use the what should I say, the sound of the bridge, like the both like the traffic, the tones, the vibrations, like of the flow to sort of reimagine or modify like the way that we hear like a song like We Shall Overcome. And I was wondering like what was part of the operation of that, like, because that's a very different way of listening like to that song. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Do you want, well, let's see. Some of the answer to like how that work functions has to do with how we think about our practice, which is, you know, listening to spaces and listening to structures, and as always, thinking about the aesthetic power in Black music, the aesthetic power, I don't know if I mean to say that, the aesthetics and the power of Black music. In that particular work, we were thinking about how to remember history and to remember people through listening to the actual song, We Shall Overcome, and also listening to the spaces. Do you want to say more about that?
Yeah. And I think to this whole question of activism in art, I mean, a lot of what we do in our projects across, you know, the years has been sort of looking at the kind of aesthetics that emerge out of activism and also aestheticizing these actions that have been used in activism. So, you know, that song, We Shall Overcome, is usually heard in a certain context, but you know, what does it mean to listen through it through the actual structure where it was performed?
I would say another part of our practice is to elongate, or, you know, to shift the time. You know, I mean, part of why we do the things is to also learn through the forms and in different ways. So in focusing on several parts of the song, like, deep in my heart, I do believe. Like, that's a long part of what actually gets engaged. That's that part of that song. And, you know, for me, I struggled with that song as a child in certain contexts and relearning it and hearing it through the bridge, thinking about the bridge, thinking about the lengthening that time. It creates a new relationship for me to that history and the way that sound works to hold that, hold meaning.
Sorry.
I mean, I also wanted to go back to something that Greg brought up about counterculture, like queer is a counterculture today. I mean, I think one strange thing about this political moment is that everyone feels like they're part of the counterculture, right? So unlike 50 years ago, it's like now people on the right also feel like they're part of the counterculture, they're part of the revolution, right? And so what happens when everybody feels like they're part of the resistance, right? We're not exactly in Empire Strikes Back anymore, you know? And so that affects aesthetics, right? That affects the kind of work that everyone makes. And and it makes it harder, you know, like we're having these discussions around museums and censorship. It makes it harder even to have, you know, a good old-fashioned conversation about censorship when everyone is a part of the resistance and everyone feels like they've been victimized.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I guess the other thing too, just when I just think about the kind of political education, you know, that I got coming up was there's also, okay, there's a way in which you environmentally think of aesthetics and politics being completely blended in the environmental frame. But, you know, the other thing as well is that in particular what the activism of the 60s and 70s was so effective at was creating spectacle, was creating guerrilla theater, you know, was creating these, like stylizing the radicality. So, you know, when you think about, you know, and costuming it as well, you know what I mean? And connecting it to to chance and connecting it to, you know, creative acts, you know, within kind of the grassroots side of it, but as well, completely kind of co-opting artists and particular like popular moments, you know, into the movement that were not necessarily intended with that kind of, with a certain kind of radical intent. You know, you can think of, you know, any number of, you know, Motown songs before you get to, you know, What's Going On and Stevie Wonder's work, Martha Reeves and, you know, Vandellas Dancing in the Street, Heat Wave, you know what I mean? So there's like the implications become amplified, you know, within a movement context because they serve a certain purpose. But, you know, I mean, I guess I've always just thought of what we call movement work as being creative acts as well, you know. Arthur Jaffer likes to talk about, you know, his first read on the Panthers was that, you know, they were just a great performance art, you know what I mean? But the thing about that is, like, it's also, they were just so, it's like they advertised themselves, they announced themselves through an act of, you know, guerrilla theater. But then as well, like, they were just as, they were as, the Panthers were as present as the internet if you were engaged with movement work in 1670 because of the magazine, because of Emory Douglas's artwork, you know what I mean? It's like they found a way of emblematizing, you know, and graphically styling, you know. Yeah, I mean, you know, creating an art that was, had high, that was a product of a very sophisticated visual aesthetic, you know, but I mean, spoke directly to the radicality of the politics they were engaged in, you know. And then, you know, but the thing is, in that period, you also just start to see the ripple effect of that on somebody like Jimi Hendrix, who, you know, he's got interviews he did in 67 about Vietnam, where he's talking about the yellow peril, because like most black people, you know, raised in the 50s and 60s, you know, you'd been completely indoctrinated with the idea that communism was going to destroy America, you know, and then by the time you get to 60, 69 and 70, you know, there's the Star Spangled Banner and, you know, Machine Gun and Freedom and, you know, so there's a way in which the creative power of the way people articulate some kind of radicality in movements, you know, has this, and you know, become, has this saturation impact on the consciousness of artists who feel, you know, who may not have even thought of themselves as political before, but definitely feel challenged by the temperature of the times to at least respond. And, you know, seeing that now as well. I mean, you know, with you know, D'Angelo, Kendrick Lamar, Solange, you know, and so forth. I mean, you know, these are all people who were massively successful, you know, in the pop arena, you know, who people, you know, wouldn't have necessarily even seen as making that kind of leap into making, you know, very pronounced connections to Black Lives Matter.
That, one question I have now, I mean, if we talk about, let's say, the aesthetics of the Panthers, you know, a lot of artist groups were generated around that same time, you know, from Afrocobra, Black Artist Group.
Yeah, AACM.
ACM. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I wonder if we see those same kind of artist groups with political, stated political goals being formed now. I mean, you know, what it means to make a political group like the Panthers is different today. Mm-hmm. But I don't, see artist groups being formed in the same kind of way that they were.
Yes. Well, it's interesting because, I mean, I think if I look at the way in which Black Lives Matter has radicalized Afropunk, you know what I mean, in terms of just the presence, you know, of political operatives and booths and so forth on the scene, you know, and then the, you know, the banner that hangs from the stage about, you know, racism, no transphobia, and all, you know. So I think that, like, you talked about, art kind of preceding activism, but, it goes both ways, you mm-hmm. know? I mean, and it's, it's interesting the way the exchange goes across mm-hmm. across time. Like, Dexter Gordon, associated with Charlie Parker, he just said he felt like that generation of the musicians were the forerunners mm-hmm. to the civil by their refusals, mm-hmm. All their refusals across the board in the way they challenged kind of mainstream definitions of what a black artist, was and so forth. So, if I look at, you look at these things in terms of scale, and there's also just the way in which things are received sometimes, like without necessarily being intending to be explicitly political. So I can look at like Kamasi Washington's mm-hmm. Presence and success, and the fact though that he comes out of a community, like that sound mm-hmm. that they work in is that, it's the sound that's very much generated in this Leimert Park, Crenshaw area, Hurst, Tapscott, Pan-African People's Orchestra, Like, there's an oral transmission, of information that informs that sound. It's very based in a time when there was more activism in that area. But, the fact that you have these guys that, 14, 15, 16 kind of claim that sound as a sound is now being recognized as being the instrumental underscore or score, for the contemporary movement. Mm-hmm. Also just says something about as I was saying with dancing in the street, like movements can actually claim something as abstract, mm-hmm. as like a modal jazz sound, as being their voice mm-hmm. in the world, in the realm of abstracted production.
Yes.
Good. I just wanted to add quickly something about the exchange that just happened between Keith and Greg, which is that was my point about counterculture, because I think that counterculture is not only organized around claiming victim status. This is almost rhetorical. I don't need to teach anyone here. But if we recall also that the Panthers had a 10-point program, mm-hmm. If we recall that the very groups that we named, like the AACM and mm-hmm. other groups, they constituted a counterculture. And this gets to Su Young's point: is does it feel differently now? Mm-hmm. And I don't know; I can't answer that. But I know it's not about what I'm yearning for when I say what about the question of counterculture is exactly those examples that were just brought up. But I'm grateful for the current examples as well. I know that there are other groups that are trying to form, like out in California, there's a group of artists who are trying to form called APEN, mm-hmm. like an organization for visual artists, like PEN exists for writers, mm-hmm. and there are other kinds of things. There was a couple of other things I wanted to throw into the conversation, which is I do think maybe it's, I'm 53, I don't know if that's important or not, but I did my activism before the internet, and there was a lot of wheat pasting, and you know what I'm talking about, mm-hmm. and telephone trees and stuff like that, and this sensibility now, like if there is a sensibility that is attached to what we could call a kind of emerging counterculture, does have to do with the hashtag, mm-hmm. it does have to do with not only amplification, acceleration, but instantaneity, mm-hmm. And coping much more with ephemerality, mm-hmm. and the theater of ephemerality. And I think that what's also interesting about the new movements today is the transparency. We followed, as many activists followed, in ACT UP, for example, a civil rights model, which was about, first of all, a commitment to nonviolence, but also there was no secrets. We couldn't be infiltrated because we kept no secrets. It was something we studied. We studied the Panthers. We studied the women's movement. We studied gay liberation. We studied post-colonialism, and thought a lot about how the history of American activism came to rest on its own shoals with a lot of help from infiltration, COINTELPRO, et cetera. I think the resistance to having visible leaders, both in Black Lives Matter and also in, there are visible spokespeople, but there's not a visible organization. Mm-hmm. And I think that this is really interesting. The reason I said my age and all that stuff is because I find that challenging, but I still find it interesting. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't know what to do with it, right? But I find it interesting. Mm-hmm. And maybe a necessity.
Well, here's the thing. So if you talk about this difference between the movements then and movements now, the movements then were very much connected to utopic social engineering projects, the whole notion of a total transformation of Western capitalist society, and enact and the prospect or the dream of engaging that in a militaristic manner, as people were gaining or being emboldened by what was going on in Africa and South America in terms of those independence movements. So there were a lot of reformulations of that kind of revolution, on American shores, and out of the Panthers came, the BLA. And the Republic of New Africa, whose utopic program was to actually claim 5 southern states as the black states of a new black nation, So contemporarily, people are not engaged in utopic, those kind of utopic visionary models of overturning the state, with the exception of the folks who were a part of the revolutionary communist folks who run revolution books and mm-hmm. the Dread is a part of. I mean, but in terms of some of the more millennial frame movements, they're not engaged in that kind of work. But what's clear if you talk to people who are involved in Black Lives Matter work is that people are still, even though people aren't on the news every day as the leader of the movement, people are being targeted and people are being assassinated. Mm-hmm. Two activists who were kind of at the forefront of the ferment that happened in Ferguson, mm-hmm. beyond the murder of Mike Brown, have both been assassinated by police in the last 2 years. And I get into these interesting conversations on, Facebook with some of my generational peers who don't feel like the name Black Lives Matter is hard enough, or the program is hard enough, or, provocative or threatening enough, And I say, yeah, but just putting black in front of anything is enough to be threatening to right-wing conservative fascists.
As evidence of this new FBI.
I was just getting to. So The Guardian just published a memo that a paper that the FBI did where they identify this new form of terrorist, which they call black identity extremists. So you might as well just say black, we've entered the era of black thought crimes.
Yeah.
Are enough for you to be targeted, for extermination, annihilation by the FBI. You know what I mean? So, one of the arguments I actually made with some of my peers is that in this context, like clearly the hashtag Black Lives Matter, when you look at the response to it, the vile and violent response to it, the way in which, it was readily identified as a terrorist organization just from the name alone, says it doesn't. The fact that it's like this is the way, and this, I think speaks to some of the work you guys do just in terms of how, you know, it's important to look at the way the coding and the framing around ideas, you know, evolves across time, because that hashtag, in this moment, it had as much impact among in the policing apparatus of the U.S. as the Panthers standing, going to that courthouse in Sacramento. You know, if you look at just the immediate level of violence that was directed at those activists who were trying to a sense like evade being identified as leaders of a movement. But you know, Alicia Garza, I think the title of her book is like, they called me, you know, called me a terrorist. You know, yeah. I was called, you know what I mean? So, you know, this speaks, it just speaks to a whole history where, like, with, you know, the as everybody knows who's done movement work, there's incredible dissension and dissent within movements, you know, around how effective they're being and whether or not they're being bold and audacious enough. But it's like your sheer presence, you know, is enough to target you. Like Claude McKay, because he wrote that poem, If We Must Die, you know, was targeted by the FBI for the rest of his life. You know what I mean? There's a whole book, actually, a scholarship that came out about the FBI's targeting of black writers over the last century. You know, these are people who were novelists, poets. And so these were people who weren't even like publicly identified with movements, but it speaks to something like, if you go to, you go to YouTube and there's a great black journalist, Gil Noble, used to have a show on ABC on Sundays called Like It Is. So there's one of those shows where he actually interviews somebody who was an undercover operative for the FBI in California. The show is called, the broadcast is called Codename Othello, right? So in there, one of the things that the guy discloses is, well, Gil asked him, said, are you familiar with the Watts Writers Theater? And he says, they said, yeah. He said, I put in the floors and installed the lights, and I was the one who burned it to the ground, you know. So that's the level of intervention you're talking about at that point in time. But one of the things he says is that, he said, there's a whole wing of the FBI devoted to the study of black culture, right? He said, and Gil says, how would you compare it with the Schomburg? He said, better. You know what I mean? So you don't have to do much to disturb, you know what I mean, the fascists in terms of their need to identify and neutralize you. You know what I mean? It's just the Panthers just decided it, in all their audacity and glory, to just like push the contradiction as far and as fast as they could. You know what I mean? But proceeding to anybody, you know, who basically was there in service to the people, which is another way I would think about artists. You know, how artists conceive of themselves and their work, you know, no matter how abstract it is, you know, you will be identified and, you know, put on the list, on the watch list, at least, you know. So.
Sorry, please.
Back to this question of, like, we talked about these earlier collectives, like the Panthers and then the artist groups. Seems like one significant difference today is that now in Black Lives Matter, for example, many of the leaders are artists, right? And so maybe we don't have this idea that we had in the past that they were sort of, you know, political organizations and then sort of artists over here. And certainly there are artists involved in the Panthers, but I don't think people thought the leaders should be artists. And now,
They were artful, though.
They were certainly artful, but now we have artists sort of leading.
Do you mean people who identify as
people
artists?
Who identify, who say, you know, my day job is that I'm an artist and I'm an activist, right?
Yeah.
And I think maybe today we think that artists have sort of useful skills to play in the movement as leaders.
Yeah, but I think that was the case in the 60s, 70s as well. You know what I mean? In greater or smaller ways. You know what I mean? Because at a certain point, everyone got wrapped up in the resistance, you know, the activism of the time, and you know, and that notion of what black was just got real complex, you know, and identity related, African, a certain kind of romantic African-American identification, you know, with an African past, an African mm-hmm. revolution, an African future, you know. There's a you know, I mean, it's like when you really, like the fact, you know, when you look at those collectives, mm-hmm. they are very much their own interpretation of the revolutionary mm-hmm. moment, mm-hmm. you know, and people, you know, again, like, if you look like Art Ensemble Chicago, mm-hmm. you know, I mean, you couldn't imagine people doing more abstract definitions of black music at the time, but in terms of what they're emblematizing and embodying through their dress and the ritual approach, you know, to creating collective sound, you know, I mean, it's completely in tune with the way in which people were kind of convening and gathering together mm-hmm. to do movement in the street. You know? Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And this part of the question actually anticipated like what I thought I might start the discussion with about like this question about is there an not just the politics of Black Lives Matter, but is there an aesthetics like to Black Lives Matter? Like, and we were talking about hashtag, its lack of visible hierarchical organization, and I think that I mean one thing and in part I was also thinking that yesterday's screening, for example, is a certain kind of and it's in the very edits like and its use of images and sound was in a sense a kind of amplified through like the movements of something like Black Lives Matter. Like, so I think one thing that is very interesting that kind of goes back to our perhaps initial question that Sondra like convened us for was that is Keith, your point about like the role of artists like in movements like Black Lives Matter, and it seemed that I was thinking Greg, your point about that there's a distinction between like the utopic function of these movements, like from say the 60s and 70s, seem to be, if not absent, seem to be like more diminished. And I think one thing can be is that I mean the very claim to a futurity, like the ability to think a future that is radically different than ours, like seems to be like much more difficult, like or general or perceived as much more difficult, like or that seems to be in part what is at stake. Like, yeah. And that it's not a given, like, and I think what's particularly interesting about something like Black Lives Matter is that it does lay, like, a certain commitment to the very precarity of everyday existence, like, and so that when artists are participating, they're also participating themselves as also workers with, like, incredible debts, like, both, like, social and financial, that impedes a certain sense of ability to even think ahead, like, when your future is already accounted for, like, through like, systems and accumulations of debt upon debt upon debt. So I'm not in, I'm just adding to.
Well, I mean, yeah, I mean, you know, it's interesting because this will tie back to AJ's film too. I mean, we know that from the beginning, one of the mandates of Black Lives Matter was also the adoption of Audre Lorde's notion of radical self-care, right? Mm-hmm. That was a conversation that some of the first students I met who had gone out to Ferguson and come back to the campus mm-hmm. when I was at Williams College a few years ago. And they were saying, well, I know what you're seeing on television is all about the street commotion, mm-hmm. the momentum. But he said, a lot of what, you know, one of the students were telling me, said, yeah, a lot of what we did was actually talk about these notions of healing. Mm-hmm. So it's like, and on a certain level, that also, as anybody who's done movie work knows, is like there's, like, how do you counter the burnout factor? Mm-hmm. So. Mm-hmm. So in addition to, like, one of the ways in which they've certainly studied the previous models is, like, okay, to address or to try to create a leaderless movement, but then also to be engaged with this internal kind of salvation, mm-hmm. you know, of the people who are engaged in the work, you know. And the thing is, if I just think in terms of music, right? If I just think in terms of the D'Angelo album, Black Messiah, Kendrick, Pimp a Butterfly, you know, Solange, See the Tape. I think it, like three records are kind of acknowledged as kind of like masterpieces of, of that moment. Those are all like very contemplative, introspective records. You know what I mean? They actually are not doing like a Bob Marley, you know, get up, stand up, you know what I mean? But in the context of those movements, they are music that has that kind of inspirational, motivational, medicinal impact, you know what I mean? So, you, and again, this is where you're looking at, and I think that's something that, in terms of the way AJ put together Love is the message, it's also, yeah, this is, it's a meditation on violence and struggle and trauma and pain, but it's very much through that lens of we're going to witness the witnessing, like, and I'm going to create a safe space, you know, which is, and it's interesting because, like, yeah, there are people like us who know AJ, for whom if AJ says, all right, I'm going to show you the film that's got a lot of triggers in it, we'll say, okay.
Right.
Shoot. But it also has that effect. I mean, there's something
in the juju
of that film that I've seen with other audiences where there's something about the way his aesthetics are working in there. They create the trust to show you things that you have not been wanting to see, like, you know, online. Yeah.
I was going to say that I completely understand and identify with why there are not utopian speculations attached to our current activisms. But I do discern a sensibility, and I was reminded when you talked about D'Angelo's album, I did something in class where we listened to Black Messiah and we listened to Marvin Gaye's What's Going On, and then we looked at the album cover art. Yeah. And so Marvin Gaye's standing there alone, face into the wind, black jacket, wet, you know, he's facing the world alone, but defiant, and how the cover art, now if you can call it cover art, of Black Messiah is actually a field of people. It's not an individual, it's a mass. And then I also related to a lot of what you're saying, you know, very inspired by Fred Moten, as we all are, and what Fred and Stefano Harney are doing in the Undercommons. So if not a counterculture, then an underground, right? An Undercommons, a place where you repair to study. You know, Fred Moten talks a lot about finding places to study and keep on studying. And places of repair, and also the music. I just kind of sent a whole bunch of synapses going off in my mind too. That the music too is about this thing that Fred talks about being low, about getting low, and staying low.
Staying in the hole.
So that was just, I'm sorry, I thought I had a clearer thought, but I was trying to point in other directions that resonated, that while not utopian in a grand horizon, are directions that I know are significant to many, not only speaking to myself.
Yeah. I mean, I think I also feel a responsibility to imagine an achievable utopia to work towards.
It's the sunrise.
It's the sunrise. Yeah, perhaps. I mean, perhaps. I mean, it's also the parent in me. I cannot. We will either imagine a doable future or we will die. You know, it's not acceptable, you know, to just imagine, you know, the trauma will continue and there's nothing that we can do.
Yeah, but I mean, but that's what, you know, I do feel that, yeah, the utopic project for now within Black Lives Matter is around these notions of self-repair and healing. And
yes,
you know what I mean? It's like, you know, because I also grew up with all of these figures coming through the house, I know the fates of many of them too. Like when those movements got disintegrated, you know, and people were just left out on their own, like without the protection of a community or a movement. Yeah, I mean, a lot of those folks, you know, were effectively exiled or neutralized, you know what I mean? And so there's also a way that focus on a community commitment to be engaged in psychic healing, you know, is a way of also kind of maintaining another front, an internal front for the movement, even though the media face of it may have to retreat in this moment because the FBI is saying, you know, okay, COINTELPRO 2.0, it's anybody we decide is committing a Black Thought crime.
Perhaps as we wrap up, like as much as our discussion has talked about amplification and expanding the spectrum of what we consider resistance, also that state terrorism, like is this in a very long history, but also not just through like the FBI list, but like the absolute destruction of welfare, of care. Like, I mean, the law after law that's passed the past few days that stripped like the care of one population to another, like so to be able to take care of ourselves, indeed, like has become like a political act. Like, so perhaps on that note, we can thank you.
Utopically.
We might find utopias in a different register.
Convenient. So, no, adjourn.
Thank you very much.